Come quickly and see. Jesus is here. He is riding on a colt entering the city of Jerusalem. Come quickly. Come and see. Is he the one who we have been waiting for? Come quickly. Come, let us worship. For Jesus is indeed the one, and he is the one we worship. Let us sing together hymn 365. Let us sing together hymn 364. Show us the way forward and through the difficulties of this life and these troubling times. Lead us towards the gates of your kingdom. Forgive us for all the times we have failed to follow you, and embolden us to do better in your steadfast love. Like those before us, we come together today in our buildings, in our homes, perhaps separated in space, but bound always in dedication to your Son, Jesus, strengthened in your Holy Spirit, and united always in your steadfast love, to shout Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We bring our praises this morning, praying also together the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our first reading this morning is Psalm 118, verses 1 and 2, and verses 19 to 29. And Brona's reading for us this morning. Thank you, Brona.
How I love you, Lord. You are my defender. The Lord is my protector. He is my strong fortress. My God is my protection, and with him I am safe. He protects me like a shield. He defends me and keeps me safe. He helped me out of danger. He saved me because he was pleased with me. The Lord rewards me because I do what is right. He blesses me because I am innocent. I have obeyed the law of the Lord. I have not turned away from my God. I have observed all his laws. I have not disobeyed his commands. He knows that I am faultless, that I have kept myself from doing wrong. And so he rewards me because I do what is right, because he knows that I am innocent. O Lord, you are faithful to those who are faithful to you, completely good to those who are perfect, and pure to those who are pure, but hostile to those who are wicked. You save those who are humble, but you humble those who are proud. O Lord, you give me light, you dispel my darkness, you give me strength to attack my enemies, and power to overcome their defences.
Our next hymn is hymn 516, We Are Marching in the Light of God. I'm not sure if some of you know this one or not, but we'll give it a go. Oh yes, sorry, we're singing it twice, just so you know. Thank you, Alison. Luke chapter 19, verses 28 to 40.
After Jesus said this, he went on ahead of them to Jerusalem. As he came near Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two disciples ahead with these instructions. Go to the village there ahead of you. As you go in, you will find a colt tied up that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If someone asks you why you are untying it, tell them that the master needs it. They went on their way and found everything just as Jesus had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, "Why are you untying it?" "The master needs it," they answered. And they took the colt to Jesus. Then they threw their cloaks over the animal and helped Jesus get on. As he rode on, people spread their coats on the road. When he came near Jerusalem, at the place where the road went down the Mount of Olives, the large crowd of his disciples began to thank God and praise him in loud voices for all the great things that they had seen. "God bless the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to God." Then some of the Pharisees in the crowd spoke to Jesus. "Teacher," they said, "command your disciples to be quiet." Jesus answered, "I tell you that if they keep quiet, the stones themselves will start shouting." Thanks be to God for these readings from his holy word. Amen.
Let's sing hymn 367. The story of Palm Sunday is featured in all four Gospels. This is, of course, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all of which tell the story of Jesus. Now, the story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, the story with the humble colt, the shouting crowds, the branches, the coats and the cloaks spread like a carpet upon the road, this story has center stage in all four Gospels. We have to remind ourselves that for this story to make it into all four Gospels is very telling in terms of how important this story is and how well it was received by the people who wrote these Gospels, something that stood out for them when they had to reflect on the story of Jesus. So just to give us some perspective, the story of Christmas didn't make it into all four Gospels. Two of the Gospels make no mention of the pregnant Mary or the shepherds watching their flocks by night, or the angels or the star or the wise men or the babe in the manger. Christmas only made it into two Gospels. The Lord's Prayer didn't make it into all four Gospels. The prayer that Jesus taught his followers made it into two of the Gospel stories. The parable of the Good Samaritan and the parable of the prodigal son appear in but one Gospel. The Beatitudes, the ones we know as blessed are the peacemakers, blessed are the meek, blessed are the poor, also made it into two of the four Gospels that we have in the Bible. But the Palm Sunday story, the story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, this story has pride of place in all four Gospels. In the church, sometimes Pentecost, this is of course the day that the Holy Spirit descended upon believers, is seen as the start of the Christian church. A commentary by Dr. Nancy Taylor from the US states that she wonders if Palm Sunday isn't the church's real birthday. She writes that Palm Sunday is the day the followers of Jesus grew up, found their voices, summoned their courage, and assumed their role as witnesses to God's will on earth as it is in heaven. This is the day. Palm Sunday is the day Jesus' followers stepped out into the world stage, stepped out in earnest as players and protagonists in the realm of God's kingdom. It's an interesting angle to the story for me, to reimagine Palm Sunday and Holy Week for that matter as a play playing out on a stage. The scene is the ancient city of Jerusalem during the annual Passover festival. The city swells with visitors from all over the world. Maybe we can imagine Edinburgh during the Fringe Festival. Every possible room is rented at a premium price. To keep the peace, Roman legions, conscripts from Roman citizens, helmeted, armored, patrolled the streets. Until this day, until this moment, until right at that moment, the followers of Jesus had been just that. Followers. They had been largely passive, reflective. They followed Jesus, they hung on his every word, they learned from him. When he argued with civil and religious officials, they watched. When he defended a prostitute, they gasped. When he conversed in public with a woman from Samaria, they winced. When he defied the Sabbath laws, they cringed. When he declared that the last shall be first and the first shall be last, and the rich poor, they glanced around guardedly to see who was listening. When he kissed lepers and healed those of broken bodies, they whispered in fascinated awe. But here, as Jesus and his followers at that stage entered the city, Roman soldiers gathered to investigate the fuss. Imagine the horses snorting, the soldiers with their armor and shields bearing Caesar's image on them. The Pharisees, the religious elite of the time, were becoming scared of all the attention the disciples' shouting and praise was attracting to the Roman soldiers. They beseeched Jesus to tell his followers to stop yelling and praising. Jesus, tell them to be quiet. We really don't need this kind of attention. Jesus answers, I tell you that if they keep quiet, the stones themselves will be shouting. Jesus says that the dam wall has broken. There is no more stopping what is about to happen. The followers of Jesus have taken what he taught and showed them into their hearts and their heads. And now there is no stopping their process of becoming the force which will, from then on until now, proclaim as the Church of God that Jesus is King. On the streets of Jerusalem, in front of God and in front of Rome and everybody, they announce and proclaim that their hearts, their allegiance, belong not to Caesar, but to a prince of a different kingdom. This is the day they shout in public that they belong to God, not to Caesar. Which in their case, in that day, is nothing less than an act of sedition. But this is, according to some scholars, where the roots of the church lie. Yes, of course, Pentecost is an important stop in the process of the church becoming church. But Palm Sunday is the day Jesus' followers become more than mere followers. They become the voice that proclaim Christ is King. Palm Sunday has pride of place in all our Gospels because this is the day the followers of Jesus become protagonists. They become actors and leaders on the stage of the world and in the kingdom of God. This is the day the church comes out in the open. This is the day the church distances itself from the state and from all worldly power. This is the day the church becomes the church. Now for us sitting here this morning, as people who are part of a long line of disciples of Jesus, when we celebrate Palm Sunday, it marks the day that it becomes our turn again to show the world what God looks like. To show the world what love looks like. To show the world what it looks like to love your enemies. And not only your enemies, but the immigrant and the alien, the stranger, the other. To show the world what it looks like to forgive those who trespass against us. And to do this not once, not seven times, but 70 times seven. Just as the disciples and crowds did on that first Palm Sunday, we too enter this week ahead as witnesses to the wonders, the love and the compassion of Jesus. We cannot be silenced by all the world can throw at us. We declare peace in a world witnessing war. We proclaim love to a world where hate has perhaps become well hidden, but still very much active. We proclaim compassion and humility in a world where power and one-upmanship is the norm. The world will turn on its head. The Bible tells us it won't be easy, it will be costly. It was on Palm Sunday that the followers of Jesus began to understand just how costly and rigorous the Christian life is. It is a way of life. This is the day the church found its feet and found its voice and swore allegiance to no earthly prince, but the Prince of Peace. The hope found in this day, in Palm Sunday, as we come into the furnace which is Jerusalem, the place we witness the worst and the best of Jesus' life. May the church be born again today. me and you, so that we go into this time knowing we are called not to simply witness Jesus' mercy, love, and compassion, but to know that we are called to live the example he showed us. Let's show the world what God looks like. Amen. Let us listen to our voluntary as we reflect on our sermon. And you listen. Your love brought us into being, and your love wraps us in care forever. We thank you for the gifts given to each of us, our world, our friends, our families, our homes. We rejoice in your presence in our lives. We bring our words of prayer for ourselves and for our world. We thank you for your eternal love and for all trying to spread it throughout our churches, communities, countries, and the world. Help each of us to understand it and live, let it live within us, not as a thought or idea, but as living, saving hope, so that we can also show it to the world around us, so that we can be the church who declares you as King. We pray for the people who try to live daily by your love, for all who live out its life-giving call to serve, caring for self and neighbour. Help us to know what your love is calling us to do and change the world for the better. We pray for all the people who seek your love in scripture, experience, religion, and nature. May their search be fruitful. May they find help along the way. And may we be a support to all who seek you. We pray for people all over the world who find that words, not love, are used like weapons against them, who are ostracized because of their wealth or background or race or gender or sexuality or ability, Help us to show your love to them, to bring peace and justice in your name, and be brothers and sisters in love to all in need. In Jesus' name, and inspired by his love, we pray. Let us sing together hymn 356. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you now and forevermore.